Avant de commencer, so before we start learning French together, I just wanted to actually tell you something, and it's the fact that French language and English language, well, they've got a special relationship. Well, the first thing that, of course, you probably know, like many other languages, French tend to take quite many new words from English, so these are called les néologismes, okay? So it does mean that you already know quite many words in French. When we're talking about the new words, of course, you will have to pronounce them a bit differently. And the second thing that you should keep in mind, maybe you don't know that already, but until the 14th century, approximately 10,000 words were introduced into English language, and they were coming from French and Norman. So what does it mean? It does mean that you know a lot, and really I mean a lot, of French words already if you master English. If it's your mother tongue, then it's quite good for you. If it's not your mother tongue, then you will encounter, while we do these this series of videos, many words that you already know because you've been learning them already in English. Okay, so this is the thing, and well, just wanted to start with that. Keep in mind that you already know quite many words in French before you even start learning it. Okay, but now we will start with a serious thing, and we will start learning French. La structure de la phrase, so the structure of the sentence in French, okay? So you'll see that in a way it's not that different from English, because we are using English here to study and for me to teach. So it means that for us it will be quite nice, because in a way French language will actually work or behave in a way similar to English. So first, normally, will come the subject, le sujet. Then you will put the verb, le verbe. And after that will come what we call les compléments. Okay, so this is the normal structure of a sentence. You start with the subject, then will come the verb, and after that you will complete the sentence with more information, so basically des compléments. Okay, so let's see now an example. Je suis français. Okay, I, so it's the subject here. Suis, so it's to be, you conjugate it. I am français, in that case it's an adjective and it's French. Okay, je suis français. So it goes in that order. You will start with the subject, then you will put the verb. You can see that the verb is conjugated here, so you will have to modify it according to the subject. And then after that you will put more informations, adjectives, or then, well, other things if you want. And then a second example. Tu habites en France. Okay. Tu, it's you. Habite, the verb is habiter, and then you conjugate it here. Habiter is to live. En France, in France. Okay, so you can see that in that case, it's what we call complément de lieu. Okay, you introduce a place here. Tu habites en France. Okay, so, but then we keep the same order, because that's normally the way we should do it. So first the subject, Then the verb, same thing here, you conjugate it according to tu. And after that, in that case, you will put en France. All right? So this is what we call a normal sentence, une phrase normale. Okay? But then, of course, as usual in French, and this is something that you will discover with all these videos that I will make, we've got some exceptions possible, and then the modification, you can modify the sentences. In some cases, okay, but then this is the basic, okay, you should keep in mind that first you will put the subject, then the verb is coming, and after that, les compléments. Le sujet, le verbe, les compléments. Je suis français, tu habites en France, and that's it. Les phrases simples, so simple sentences, and we'll see that right now. So, les phrases simples in French language are la phrase interrogative, la phrase affirmative, la phrase négative, la phrase exclamative, la phrase impérative. Okay? So, la phrase interrogative, interrogative sentence, la phrase affirmative, affirmative sentence, la phrase négative, negative sentence, la phrase exclamative, exclamation, la phrase impérative, imperative sentence. And we'll start, of course, with the first one. So for each type of sentence, I will put an example. Okay, so let's start with la phrase interrogative. Aimez-vous le fromage? Okay, so the first thing that you should notice is this point d'interrogation here, and then keep in mind that in French we will put a space before. Okay, the second thing that you can notice is that you've got the verb here, aimer, aimer is to like or to love, and then you will have this vous, so it's the you, okay, and it's the plural form, aimez-vous, do you love, le fromage, so it's cheese, of course, it's a question that a French person could ask, you know, do you love cheese, do you like cheese? And, well, the first thing, or the second, because the first one was le point d'interrogation, the second thing that you could notice is that if we want to respect the rule when we ask a question, we should change the order of the sentence. So, normally in French, we've got first the subject, then the verb, but when we ask a question like that, and we want to, well, respect the rule, then we should first put the verb, then the subject. Okay, I will make some videos explaining how it works in real situations, or if this is the way that people do normally when they ask a question. Okay, but this is the way it should be done. Okay, so this is a question, c'est d'une phrase interrogative. Aimez-vous le fromage? Aimez-vous le fromage? And remember, you need to raise your voice a little bit at the end. Aimez-vous le fromage? Phrase affirmative. Oui, j'aime le fromage. So in that case, you just want to say that you like or you love cheese. And then this is affirmative. You will start with oui here. Oui, j'aime le fromage. Okay, so you can see that in that case, you will use this je. Okay, I will explain in a the next video why the E is disappearing here, but then it's I like, I love, okay? Oui, j'aime le fromage. So you keep the same order, subject, and then verb, okay? So the order that actually normally we've got in the French language, you will start with the subject and after that the verb is coming. La phrase négative. Okay, so in that case, you want to say non. Okay, non, je n'aime pas le fromage. No, I don't like cheese. Okay, and in that case, well, we'll see that a bit later as well. You will use this ne and then pas. So basically, when we introduce the negative form in French, we will have two parts. That will be before and after the verb, okay? Non, je n'aime pas le fromage. La phrase impérative. Mangeons ce fromage. Okay, and in that case, you can see quite clearly that you've got what we call le point d'exclamation here at the end. Keep in mind that you should put a space before it, okay? So, point d'exclamation, and normally it means that you will use that whether to give an order, in most of the cases it will be for an order, or then if you want to give an advice, it's possible as well, okay? And in that case, mangeons, so it's at the new form, okay? So, we eat, okay, so let's eat, but then in that case it could be an order, so eat this cheese, okay? You can see that we will see when we'll discover l'impérative form together that this nous, so the subject is not here. It's something quite special for the imperative form. You take away les pronoms personnels. Mangeons ce fromage, okay? And in that case this sentence is une phrase impérative. Phrase exclamative. And in that case, it's actually interesting because it's so short. And in a way, it's a sentence even if you don't have any verb. Because here, quel, what, and then bon, good, fromage. So one more time, cheese. What a good cheese, quel bon fromage, okay? It's a sentence, but then clearly you don't have any verb, okay? So it means that in some cases, like this one for instance, you can have sentences without having a verb in them, okay? And it's here in phrase exclamative, quel bon fromage. Le sujet. And we'll see actually in this video what in French can be subject of a sentence. Okay, le sujet, the subject. And basically it can be un nom, un pronom interrogatif, un pronom indéfini. Okay, so when we're talking about, when we're talking about a subject, it can be un nom, and it's a noun, un pronom personnel, and it's a subject pronoun, un pronom interrogatif, interrogative pronoun, or then un pronom indéfini, indefinite pronoun. And we'll see, and we'll of course start with the first one, un nom. Okay, so let's start with un nom, and I just wanted to have a simple sentence in that case, and it will be Vincent enseigne le français. Okay, so Vincent is a first name, and it's mine, by the way. Enseigne, here you've got a verb, so the verb is enseigner, and it's conjugated in that case, le français, so it's French, and we're referring to French language. Vincent enseigne le français. And in this sentence, you can see quite easily that Vincent here is the subject of the verb here. Okay? So we could also change this Vincent take it away and then put le professeur, and it means the teacher, and it will stay also the subject of the sentence, so it's connected directly to the verb enseigner here. Le sujet peut être un pronom personnel, so it can be also a subject pronoun as we saw. So let's see now how it would go. And in that case, same thing, simple sentence to start. Il visite Paris. Okay, so you get il here, I-L, visite. This is the verb visiter, you conjugate it. Il visite Paris. So in that case, you can see also quite easily that this is the subject of the sentence, and it's what we call un pronom personnel. So in English it's more clear because it's subject pronoun, so no doubt about the function, and actually we'll discover them together. So the first one is je, I, tu, you, il, he, elle, she. Okay, so je, tu, il, elle. And then for the plural form, we have nous, we, vous, you. So for the plural form, as in English, we tend to use it, well, of course, for the plural form, and also for the polite form. If you meet someone for the first time, it would be nice to use vous instead of tu. Il, they, so it's the masculine in that case, and then elle, they, but it's the feminine in that case. So in French we make the difference between the masculine form and the feminine form when we use les pronoms personnels at the plural. Okay, so je, tu, il, elle, nous, vous, il, elle. All right. And so let's see now un pronom interrogatif. So same thing, simple structure, simple sentence, and the sentence is qui parle, so it's a question. Okay, so the verb is parler, parler is to talk. Okay, and then when you put this qui, and qui is who, basically this qui becomes of course the subject in this sentence, and it's a question. Who is talking? Qui parle? Qui parle? And the last one will be un pronom indéfini. And it's also quite useful, and I just wanted to make a simple sentence as well to make it clear. Same verb, parler is to talk, and then quelqu'un, someone or somebody. Okay, and in that case, quelqu'un parle, somebody is talking, someone is talking, and in that case you can see quite easily that quelqu'un is the subject of the sentence. Le sujet et le verbe, so the subject and the verb. And it's actually quite important when we start to learn French, just to know that in French, basically, the subject will affect the verb. Okay, so I just wanted to take a simple example first, because we will focus on the conjugation a bit later. So it's not the idea of this lesson. The idea of this lesson is just to show you that basically the relationship between the subject and the verb is quite close, because the verb will be affected by the subject. So the verb is marcher. Marcher is to walk. Okay, and let's take the example of il. Okay, so it's he. And basically, when you use il, you will have to conjugate the verb. So conjugate the verb means that for each form, you will have a specific ending. Okay, this is the basic form here, marché. It's what we call the infinitive, all right? But then you don't reuse marché just like that. You will have to conjugate it, so you will have to modify the ending according to the subject. In that case, il requires that you will put this final e here, so you will get il marche. All right, so whoops, sorry, the R is coming now. And then it will be exactly the same thing for the plural form of il. So they, il marche. And if you look carefully, the ending is different. Okay, we will see everything covering the conjugation a bit later. It's just to show you that the subject is basically affecting quite much the verb. Okay, and so when we're talking about this topic, basically it's quite good to have a general view of the conjugation of marcher, so how it will be modified according to the subject. So the first person, je, I, you will get je marche. Tu marches. Il, elle. Okay, so tu is for you, the singular form, and then il, he, elle, she. Marche. Nous marchons. So it's we, the plural form. Vous, you, the plural form. Marcher. And then il, oops, sorry, elle, and the plural, marche. So you can see that basically the forms are different, and it's one important thing that you've got to keep in mind, and that can be a bit tricky or difficult at the beginning, but then once you get used, you will remember the endings. Okay, so basically the subject will affect the verb. Okay, and it was the topic of this video. Les lettres, so the letters, and basically it is quite important because, of course, when you learn a language, well, you get to know the letters and you want to pronounce it correctly. So this is exactly what we'll try to do here. I will show you the letters, okay? So we'll divide them into two groups, the vowels and the consonants, and then I will pronounce them, okay? So let's first start with the vowels. And in French, we have six vowels, six voyelles, okay? Six voyelles, and the first one is A, E, I, O, U, Y. Okay, this one is quite tricky for some of you, maybe, because maybe in your languages this Y is not a vowel but a consonant. In French, it is a vowel. Okay, A, E, I, O, U, Y. Okay, and then let's see the consonants, and we've got 20 consonnes, so 20 consonants, and the first one is B, C, D, F, G, H, J, K, L, M, N, P, Q, R, S, T, V, W, X, Z. Okay, so it's B, C, D, F, G, H, J, K-L-M-N-P-Q-R-S-T-V-W-X-Z. Okay, so it was just to present you these letters, so the six vowels and a 20 consonant that we do have in French. Don't worry, in the coming videos we will focus on the pronunciation and we'll see how to go combine them and how to pronounce them when we combine them, okay? But then keep them in mind and try to practice on your own, okay? Les modes et les temps. So basically, when you translated that directly, we're talking about moods and tenses. So basically, like in English, if you want to use a verb, and normally when you will use a verb, you will have to basically decide whether you are using a certain mood and also whether you are using a certain tense for this verb, just because the moods and the tenses will be used in specific context or situations. Okay, so let's see now les modes. Okay, and basically in French we've got the first one that you will use and the first one that we will see together in the coming lessons will be l'indicatif. Okay, and l'indicatif is used to express the reality, so what is really happening. Then we'll have le conditionnel. Okay, so basically, like in English, we will use it to express what we call l'éventualité, something that might happen. Okay, and then we'll have this imperative form as well, so imperative mood, sorry, just to express l'ordre, the order, or then le conseil, advice. And then we'll have this subjonctif, which can be quite tricky, especially at the beginning, because it doesn't exist really in English, and it's to express what we call le sentiment. Okay, so basically we'll have these main moods, so l'indicatif, le conditionnel, l'impératif, and then le subjonctif. It does mean that in all these moods, dans toutes ces modes, you will have different tenses as well. Okay, and that's what we are going to see next, because basically when we're talking about les temps, the tenses, well, I will make it simple, okay, and we'll see in the coming or in the next videos how it will work. But mainly you will express three things with these tenses, and the first one is le présent, okay, the present, then le futur, the future, and then le passé, the past. And we will see that for all these three options we will have different ways of expressing them, so it does mean that we will have not only three tenses but much more. Okay, no stress about that, don't worry, we'll do it little by little. So, but just to keep in mind that when we're talking about the tenses, well, we express normally le présent, le futur, and then le passé. Okay, so keep in mind that we get les modes. Okay, so le mode, and you get to decide what mode or what mood, sorry, you will have to use: indicatif, conditionnel, imperatif, or then subjonctif. And the second thing that you have to choose is the correct tense, le temps, and then it's présent, futur, and passé. And keep in mind that, as I said, we've got quite many tenses, but we'll see that a bit later. les signes diacritiques. And I know that the title is quite scary, and you probably think that, oh, I don't want to watch this video. But trust me, it's quite important for a good reason. And well, basically, what is les signes diacritiques? It's the idea that at one point in the language, we will use un signe, a sign, something that you will add to a letter, and by adding this sign to the letter, it will make a new letter. Okay? And it's something quite common in French, and we'll see exactly what we are talking about, because even if it's scary, the good news is that we've got only 5 signes diacritiques. 5 signes diacritiques. And the first one is accent aigu. Okay? The second one is accent grave. Third one is accent circonflex, then tréma, and last but not least, cédille. Okay, so accent aigu, accent grave, accent circonflex, tréma, and then cédille. So let's start with l'accent aigu, and it basically, it looks like that. Okay, so this is l'accent aigu, and let's see. You will actually put l'accent aigu on the top of E, okay? It doesn't come on the top of A, I, O, U, Y, it's only on E, okay? So keep in mind that l'accent aigu is only coming right here on the top of E, okay? Then you will have l'accent grave, and it goes in the other direction. Okay, but then l'accent grave is actually more used because you can put it on the top of A, on the top of E, and then on the top of U. Alright? After that you've got l'accent circonflex, so it's like a little roof here, like a little hat, and it will come on the top of A, E, I, O, and U. Then tréma, just like two little dots here, and it will come on the top of A, E, I, O, and then U. Okay, and the last one, la cédille, if you look carefully, basically it will come right below your C letter. Okay? So remember, l'accent aigu, l'accent grave, l'accent circonflexe, le tréma, la cédille. Alright? And the idea, of course, in this video, is only to present these 5 signs. So in the next lessons, in the next units, I will focus on explaining how to pronounce them, because of course the pronunciation will change. If you put l'accent aigu on the top of E, basically you won't pronounce it like you would pronounce it without the accent. Okay? But then keep in mind that we've got these 5 signes diacritiques. Accent aigu, accent grave, accent circonflexe, tréma, cédille. Les ligatures. So even if it's a bit scary, let's start the video. And basically, what are we talking about when we're talking about les ligatures? Well, we're talking about 2 letters, some strange letters, you might say. This is the first one, and this is the second one. They are quite rare in the French language, but basically you can see them and you need to know what they are, and that's the reason why I've been making this little video. So the first one is this e dans la. Okay, so basically if you translate directly, it's inside or in a, and that's the reason why, because if you look carefully, it's only one letter here, and like if these two letters were glued, okay, or connected like that, so it's e dans la. Let's see a few examples of words that use this e dans la, and the first one is curriculum vitae, the second one is ex aequo, then etc., and then ad vitam aeternam. And so if you look carefully at these words, you realize that this letter is coming directly from Latin. Okay, so and it's quite rare to see this letter in French language. Well, you've got here some examples, but I've been choosing the more common examples, because the other one probably you will never use them, or maybe never encounter them. But anyway, it is rare, but it does exist, and it can be a challenge in some cases for some of you to write this letter correctly if you want to write it with your computer, because you've got to go through insert and then after that symbol. So basically it's up to you. If you want to write it correctly, you should put of course this e dans la. If you don't manage to put it, then just put a and after e. Maybe your computer will correct it automatically, you never know. Okay, the second one is this one, and it's e dans l'eau. So basically the same concept, so e inside o. Alright, so because it's only one letter here, and you get this O and E connected, like glued, okay, to each other. So let's see, because this one is actually used a bit more often, and I've been selecting few words, and the first one is un bœuf, un cœur. It's actually quite interesting, because even if you write them differently, you pronounce them the same way. Un œil, un œuf, une sœur. Okay, so un bœuf, un cœur, un œil, un œuf, une sœur. All right. So these words are actually not that rare, and we'll see exactly what they mean. The first one, un bœuf. Okay, steer, ox, or then un cœur, heart, un œuf, egg, un cœur, is it choir, choir? I'm not really sure about the pronunciation in English, sorry about that, I don't want to make any mistake. Then we've got un œil, eye, and then une sœur, sister. Okay, and this letter is actually more often used, okay, than the previous one, and then it's, well, basically it will be exactly the same challenge if you want to write it correctly with your computer, whether you try to find this letter by inserting a symbol, okay, or then you just put O and then after that you will put E, okay. Technically it's a mistake, but then basically if you cannot make in another way, then just write it O and E, okay? Le masculin et le féminin, so the masculine and the feminine. And actually, in French, when it comes to grammar, we've got the difference between the masculine form and the feminine form, and we'll see that it will affect quite deeply the language. For instance, we've got, when it comes to les pronoms personnels, we will have the difference between the masculine and the feminine. So we'll start with the feminine, ladies first, and it's elle, okay? So she, So in that case, it is the feminine singular form, elle. Okay? For the masculine, it will be il. So in English, it will be he. Okay? Il. So in that case, it's the masculine singular form. When it comes to the plural, actually in French, we also have the difference between the feminine and the masculine. So basically here, elle, it's the feminine plural form. Okay? And then in the same way here, il will be the masculine plural form. So if you look carefully, the only difference between the singular and the plural, it's this final S here. Same thing here between il and il, it's the final S. And if you listen carefully, basically you don't have any differences. So it's elle and elle, il and il. Okay, the grammar rule is quite strict in French. If you've got a group of persons and in this group you get at least one man, it will be masculine. Okay, so let's see now if you discover a new word. Okay, so it could be a noun, it could be an adjective. In that case, the good reflex would be to try to see and to try to remember whether it's feminine or whether it's masculine, okay? Because it will basically affect after that, and we'll see that in this video, what will come after, and in most of the cases we're talking about the adjectives, okay? So it's always good to remember the gender of a word, okay? Of course, in that case, if you're encountering a new noun, so basically you try to remember the gender at the same time. I will make some videos covering the topic and that giving you a few tips to try to see, you know, whether it's masculine or feminine according to the ending of the word. In some cases it can help, but in most of the cases you will have to remember the gender. Just when you discover a new word, try to remember the gender at the same time. Okay, so for a good reason, and this is now what I will explain it. Well, basically, when you've got a noun, it will actually be connected to an adjective, and whether it's masculine or feminine, basically in French the adjective will be changed also. So let's see an example here. We've got un pays chaud. So if we translate directly, it's un pays, it's a country, and it's chaud is warm, hot. Okay, un pays chaud. So you can see that here, pays is masculine. Un is the article, the masculine article, un pays chaud. And in that case, your adjective is like that, written at the basic form. So the masculine form is the basic form. And if we take another word, like boisson, boisson is feminine. Une boisson. Okay, so here you've got the article, and it's the feminine form of the article, une boisson, and you can see that here your adjective is changing. You will have to put this final e, chaude, okay, at the end, and then the pronunciation will change a little bit, chaude. So here you pronounce the final d, whereas in the masculine form you don't pronounce it. Okay, all right, so it's just an introduction, don't worry. In the coming videos, I will explain everything. So the articles, the adjective, the way to put the feminine form, everything. So in this video, it's just to show you that basically the masculine and the feminine, so whether it's a noun at the masculine and at the feminine, it will affect the adjective connected to it. Okay, and then it's also actually possible that the noun, or as we saw, le pronom personnel, will affect the verb. We are talking in that case about what we call compound tenses. So we will cover that probably in unit 4, 5, or 6. Have a look there. We're talking about le passé composé, for instance, so the past tense. And basically, let's have a look there. You will have il est allé. Okay, it's the masculine form here. So allé is to go. And this is the compound tense of il est allé, all right? And then you will have here, elle est allée, so basically, he went, she went, all right? And here, you can see that you will have the difference between the masculine and the feminine. But don't worry about that, because I will explain that later. It's just to show you that, basically, the difference between the masculine and the feminine will concern, of course, the subject, so pronom personnel, and then the nouns, but it will also affect what is coming after, so it can be an adjective, as we saw, or it can be a verb. In that case, it's a compound tense, so it's this past tense, le passé composé. All right, so no stress about that. I will explain everything after, okay? Just keep in mind that we've got a difference between the masculine and the feminine. And so my tip for this video will be, when you discover a new word, as I said, try to remember whether it's masculine, or sorry, feminine here, or masculine. Okay? Merci beaucoup. Oui et non. Oui et non. So basically, yes and no. Oui et non. So because I thought, you know, it might be useful to make this video. In some situations, I've been assuming that people would understand and would know how to use oui et non, but it's not always the case. And well, basically, I don't expect them to do that. And as I am doing this video and this series of videos for beginners and total beginners, then this is the reason why I thought it might be useful to introduce oui, yes, and then non, no. So basically, when you have a question here, well, in French, you can answer with oui, yes, or then with non, no. It might seem simple, but it's just the way it is, and let's make it quite clear. And that's the reason why we have this question. Vous parlez français? Okay, basically, do you speak French? I just put that in that order, because normally it should be verb first and after the subject if we want to construct a correct question. But in many situations, especially when we talk, we can keep the same order, we just need to raise the voice at the end. So, of course, l'Académie Française would like me to put them in the other order, but basically you will hear many French people and many French-speaking people just keep the same order and raise their voice at the end. Okay? Vous parlez français? So basically it's a question, do you speak French? And in that case you've got, well, two possible answers, and if you want to actually answer, in a short way, the first option would be oui, or then non. Of course, at one point, and that's the reason why we'll have these videos, you will have the possibility to construct sentences, but basically if you want to answer shortly, it's not rude, it's quite, just you just show that you don't really want to talk that much, but basically you just answer to the question. So, oui, yes, and then non, no. Let's see now how it will work if we have a question, but if this question is at the negative form, okay? Because in that case, it's somehow a bit tricky, because strangely, for the affirmative answer, it won't be oui, but it will become si. And then for the negative, it will be exactly the same, it will be non. Okay, so keep in mind if you get a question, but then this question is at the negative form, then instead of using oui, you will use si, but then non will be the same. Okay, so let's see the same question. Vous ne parlez pas français? So you don't speak French, okay? So this is how it works for the negative form. Don't worry, in few videos I will explain you how it works exactly, okay? But at this point it's only to introduce oui, non, si, non, okay? So it's a negative question in that case. You don't speak French? And the answer would be si, or then non. Obviously, at one point you would like to make sentences instead of using these two possibilities, okay? But it's just to show you that, you know, actually you've got these two options. So if you've got a question, the first one would be oui or then non. If it's a negative question, then it will be si or non, okay? La ponctuation. So let's discover together the punctuation in French. Okay, so we can start, and I thought it might be useful to start with this one, and it's le point. Okay, so le point. And for this video, I will actually tell you how to put these punctuation signs, and if we need to put some spaces or not, because it does change a little bit if you compare it to English, for instance. So let's see now, le point. So let's imagine that you will have your sentence, or it could be a word like that, and after that you will put le point, then you will have to put a space and the next word will come, okay? So it could be a sentence before, a sentence after, but the main thing is to remember that you don't have any space before, but you will have one after, okay? So let's see now the next one, and it's le point virgule, okay? Le point virgule, and le point virgule works like that, mot numéro un. Then you will put le point virgule without any space, then a space and the next word or the rest of the sentence, okay? La virgule, okay? So la virgule. And for la virgule, actually you will have the first word, then la virgule is coming without any space, then you will put a space and the rest of the sentence or the next word is coming after, okay? Nothing before, one space after. Le point d'interrogation. Le point d'interrogation, okay? And in that case, keep in mind that you will have whether your sentence or this word, then, and this is quite important because it does change from other languages, you put a space, you put le point d'interrogation, okay? Then after that, a space, and the rest will follow. Okay, so this is quite important. Remember that we will put in French a space before le point d'interrogation, because it's not the case in, well, some other languages, okay? And now, le point d'exclamation, okay? So le point d'exclamation, you will have your sentence and then the previous word, then un espace, space, then you will put your point d'exclamation here, after that a space, and the next word is coming. Same thing as we had for le point d'interrogation. Remember that you will have to put a space before. Les deux points, okay, les deux points, and then they work like that. Le mot, then you will have to put space, Les deux points are coming right after, another space after, then the rest will come. Okay, so remember, one space before, one space after. Les guillemets. Okay, les guillemets. And concerning les guillemets, actually, it will go like that. So you will have your sentence or, well, the previous word, then a space, then the first one. After that, a space, then you put what you want to put between them. Another space, guillemets again, space, and the rest of the sentence or the next word or whatever you want here. But you've got to keep in mind that here it's quite tricky. Space, then guillemets, space, what you put between, space, guillemets, space, and what comes after. Les points de suspension. Les points de suspension. And regarding les points de suspension, it will come like that. So what comes before, le mot, or then the sentence, and then les points de suspension, space, and then the next word, or what comes after the sentence, if you want. Okay, so nothing before, a space after. Les parenthèses, okay, and regarding les parenthèses, well, the first word, then you will put a space, then the first part, so la première parenthèse, your word, or then group of words, fermez la parenthèse, then you will put a space, and after that, the next part is coming. Okay, so remember, before and after, nothing between. Okay? Écrire en français. So, write in French. And, well, I thought it might be useful to just make this little video because I've been teaching for quite many years now and I've been noticing that at one point my students tend to be a bit disappointed or sad because they just realized one important thing in French. And it's the difference between what je prononce, I pronounce, and j'écris, I write. Because basically you can see that, of course, you will have some connections between what you pronounce and what you write, but we've got many, many things that we will have to write and we won't pronounce. I thought it might be useful to start and give you an example here with the verb parler, okay? So we will make the conjugation. Remember that we will focus on the conjugation in another video that will come a bit later, okay? But it's just to give you a good example here. So parler is to speak or to talk, and it's a regular verb, so it belongs to the first group ending with er. So let's see how we conjugate it at the present tense. Je parle, tu parles, il, elle parle, nous parlons, vous parlez, il, elle parle. Okay, so basically you get here this je and it's I, je parle, I talk, I speak, tu, and tu is for you, okay, and it's the singular form. Tu parles, here, you talk, you speak. Il, it's for the masculine form, he, il, and then elle, feminine form, she, elle. Okay, so il, elle, and then we've got the same form, parle. Then comes the plural form, nous, so oui, okay, and in that case it's nous parlons, vous, you, so it's the plural form, or then we will see a bit later that it can be also for the singular if it's the polite form, okay, vous parlez, and then we've got il, so they, but then in French we divide and we make the difference between the masculine plural, so il here, and elle, the feminine plural. Il, elle, parle. Alright, so we get je parle, tu parles, il parle, elle parle, nous parlons, vous parlez, il parle, elle parle. And if you look carefully, you write it with e here. E-S, E, then you get E-N-T here. So I only take these four forms just for a good reason. It's just because if you look carefully and if you listen to me, I will pronounce it je parle, tu parles, il parle, elle parle. So it does mean that even if you write them differently, E, ES, and then ENT, you will pronounce them the same way. And this is basically the difficult thing about French language. It's just the big difference between what you say, what you pronounce, and what you write. Okay? So in this example, for this verb, actually, if we finish it like that, you can see that you've got three phonetical forms. The first one is parle, okay, the yellow one. Then you've got nous parlons, and then you've got vous parlez. But of course, at one point, if you want to write it correctly, you will have to remember the endings, and you will have to put this S here, for instance, if you want to write it correctly, or then ENT here, even if you pronounce them the same way. Okay, so my advice would be, if you want to be happy, well, basically, when you see, it's coming, yeah, when you see a new word, a nouveau mot, well, word in general, so it can be a verb, it can be an adjective, it can be a noun, whatever. When you see a new word, try to remember, of course, how you will pronounce it, but then try also to remember how to write it correctly. And in this first lesson, I thought it would be, or it might be useful to start with the pronunciation of the vowels, okay? And after that, of course, consonant will come, but it will be in the next lesson, okay? So let's see now for the vowels, how it goes. So the first one is A, okay? A, so not really difficult to pronounce for most of you. Second one is E, repeat, E, okay? Remember that on this vowel we can put some accents, okay, and then it will affect the way you will pronounce the E, okay, but if it's like that without any accent and you need to spell it or to pronounce the letter, it's E, okay, E. Next one is E, E, then O. Okay, so don't be afraid to put your mouth really round, O, O, okay, so it's quite deep, O, okay, then U, U, so this U can be tricky, so from my experience of teaching, I've been noticing that, well, in most of the cases, for American people, it can be quite tricky at the beginning, so you really need to insist on that, it's U. Okay, Spanish speaking persons can have some difficulties as well for that. Okay, so don't be afraid to pronounce. So really it's not oo, because in most of the cases that's the mistake people tend to make. They pronounce it like oo, okay? Now in that case it's really oo, so really narrow sound. Okay, so don't be afraid to insist on that. And the last one is, well, it's Y. So if you need to spell it, then you say Y. Okay, when you pronounce it, it's like E. E. Okay, but the name of the letter is Y. Okay, so if we check them again one more time, this one is A, then comes E, E, O, U, remember, U, and the last one, Y for the name, okay, but then the pronunciation is E, all right? And in this lesson, we'll discover the pronunciation of the consonant, so les consonnes. Are you ready? So let's start now. Okay, so les consonnes. B. B. Okay, so this one shouldn't be that difficult to produce. B. B. Then comes C. Okay. C. D. D. F. F. G. G. Okay, so if we want to repeat them one more time. B. C. D. F. G. Okay, let's see the others. H. H. J. J. K. K. L. L. M. M. Okay, one more time. H. J. K. L. M. Okay, and then of course it continues. N. N. P. P. Q. Q. R. R. So it's quite important because people tend to think that French people are making this like that really deep and really well, it will hurt your throat if you try to insist too much on that. And if you listen to me, well, basically it's not that strong. R, R. Okay, so it's quite soft. R, R. The next one is S. S. Okay, so let's see them one more time. N. P. Q. R. S. And the last consonant are T. T. V. V. W, W, okay, so we've got this double, 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 and then V, W, okay, X, X, and the last one, Z, Z, okay, so remember to pronounce this D at the end, Z, Z, okay, so let's see them one more time. T, V, W, X, Z. Discover les accents, so the accents. And normally when we talk about the accents, we tend to insist on the accents which are on the top of the letter E, okay, because they will change the pronunciation of the letter. When you put the accents on the top of O, E, or A, well, nowadays we don't really pronounce the differences. But then E is still affected by that, so you should really, really first remember the name of the accent, okay? And it's normally like that, okay? And then the sound that you will have to pronounce or to produce when you see it on the top of the E, okay? Because, so without any accent, this letter, if you remember, we saw that previously, is pronounced okay? But then when you put this one, so this one is called accent aigu, okay? It goes like that, in that direction, okay? And you will pronounce the letter like A, okay? Listen to the difference. Without the accent, with the accent, A, okay? Without and with A, all right? Second accent that we can work on, it's a little bit the same, but it goes in the other direction. So if you look, it goes like that, okay? And then it's called accent grave, okay? And the sound that you will have to produce is A. So it's really open. I mean, the sound is really open, and normally your mouth should be opened a little bit more than with the accent aigu as well. Okay, so it goes like A. All right, don't be afraid to insist a little bit on the pronunciation, okay? First, and then you can make it shorter after, of course. All right, so let's compare them. The first one is A, and then the second one is A. All right, the good news is that the next one, so accent circonflexe, is pronounced like accent grave. Okay, so it's the same pronunciation here, okay, and it's the open one, okay, A, right, okay, A, all right, so you can see that it's just like a little hat that you get to put on the top of A, okay, so let's see one more time the differences, this one A, okay, and then these two accents, like here, A, open, A, okay? The last one, tréma, well, basically it's quite rare, and the tricky thing is that in some cases you will have to pronounce it like A, okay? Like, for instance, Noël, okay? But then in some cases as well, it can be pronounced like A, okay? So my advice would be try to remember the word, and they are really, really rare. So don't be afraid about that. Okay. So, but that, let's focus on the three main accents here. Okay. The first one, accent aigu. Remember, A. Accent grave, A. And the last one, accent circonflexe, A. So we'll focus on the les caractères spéciaux, so the special characters that maybe you will have to use if you want to, well, spell your name, or then if you want to give a web address or something like that. So because normally they can be quite useful and at the really beginning, so it's quite useful to spend a little time on them. Okay, so let's start now. Les caractères spéciaux, the first one, okay. If you look at it, it's here, okay, and we called it tiré, okay, tiré, all right, let's see the second one, same thing, but it's, you know, the low one, so we call it tiret bas. Tiret bas. Okay, so remember the first one located in the middle is tiret, and the other one here is tiret bas. Okay, let's see the other one. So officially we called it arrobase, arrobase, okay, but then, well, let's be honest, we can hear many French people or French speaking people using this at, okay, but then the French were, of course, at, all right, but officially it should be arrobase, okay, so don't be surprised if someone is using that, or then you can use it as well, because that's the way it should be used, so arrobase, okay. Here, so the dot, okay, because it's not always easy to spot here, we call it point, okay, point, all right, so one more time, tiret, tiret bas, arrobase, point, okay, and then it continues a little bit. So if you want to indicate that you've got, well, a double letter, okay, you can say, so in that case it's P, okay, so you say deux, okay, deux it's two in French, deux, okay, P, deux P, okay, if it would be another letter, then you would say deux, and then the name of the letter, of course. Then, this one here is called apostrophe. Okay, apostrophe, apostrophe, okay, and the last one for this lesson, here you can see that in some cases, so we'll see that a bit later, I mean the reason why, but still you can have this little thing beneath the C, okay, and that's what we call cédille, cédille, okay, cédille. Yeah, 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 cédille. Okay? And we'll discover a quite important thing, because it's a verb, and it's the verb être, okay? Être means to be, okay? So as in many, many languages, to be is quite useful, just for a simple reason. You tend to use it quite often, and then we can use it to construct some composed tenses that we'll see a bit later. Okay, so let's see how it goes at the present form. Le verbe être first is je suis. Je suis. Okay, je. It's the pronom personnel, so it's I, okay? Suis, I am, okay? Je suis, all right? Then second person, tu es, okay? So remember, être is really tricky, especially when it comes to pronunciations, okay? So first one, suis, as you've been noticing, you don't pronounce the final S, okay? And for tu, then you've got this combination of letters, okay, but then basically the sound you will pronounce or you will produce is e, okay, tu es, all right, je suis, tu es, okay, so let's see the next one, so you get this il, okay, so it's a capital letter, but then it's still it's I and then l, okay, il, so it's he, okay, masculine form, and then l, she, so feminine form, okay, and this is the verb, so il est, or then elle est, so you can notice that even if we write them differently, this est like that and est like that, we pronounce them the same way, and that's usually the difficult thing, you know, with a French language, what you write and what you pronounce can be quite different, okay? So remember, je suis, tu es, il est, elle est, okay? So let's see how the next one comes. Here it's nous, nous, okay? Sorry about that. Oops. Nous sommes, okay? Nous sommes, okay? So you don't pronounce the final S here. It doesn't exist. Sommes. Nous sommes, okay? Then, the next one is coming. Vous êtes. Same thing here. Notice that final S is not pronounced. Et, et, okay? And then, in French, we tend to have this liaison. So liaison, it's like a link, okay, that we can make between the words. So in that case, vous is ending with S, and then you tend to make a little link between them. So vous êtes, z, it goes like that. Vous êtes, okay? Vous êtes, vous êtes. Alright, so let's see one more time. Je suis, tu es, il est, elle est, nous sommes, vous êtes. Okay, and let's see the last one. Il. Okay, so you can notice that even if you've got this S at the end, and then here you don't have anything, well, you pronounce them the same way. Okay, il, singular form, il. Plural form, okay? Ils sont, final T not pronounced. Ils sont, elles sont, okay? Ils sont, elles sont. So let's see it again. Je suis, tu es, il est, elle est, nous sommes, vous êtes, ils sont, elles sont. All right. One more thing to notice, because it's quite important. This vous form, okay, can be used for the plural, of course, and then it's the polite form that we use if you meet someone for the first time. Let's say it's someone that you are connected to professionally, or it's, well, someone important, or then, well, in that case, or then you don't know this person, you should use definitely this vous, okay, for the first time. It's the polite form. After that, you can decide whether you want to use this tu form, okay, which is normally quite common in French, but then first, remember that vous is better, okay? Let's see a few examples now. Okay, first, I've been writing this this question. So, quelle est votre nationalité? Okay, so here to show you that it's here. Quelle means what, est, is, votre, your. So it's according to this vous. Okay, so the polite form of your, and then nationalité, nationality. Okay, so let's repeat the question. Quelle est votre nationalité? All right. And in French, we tend to raise the voice at the end when we've got this little point d'interrogation. If it's a question, don't be afraid to go like, yoop, and raise a little bit at the end. Okay. So, quelle est votre nationalité? Okay. Quelle est votre nationalité? So if you want to present or to say where you're from, okay? So we're using this être for that, you know. Je suis, okay, so you get here it already. And then you put this français, français, okay? It's French. Je suis français. Je suis français, okay? Then another example. Quel est votre nom de famille? Famille, family, nom, name. So, nom de famille, family name, last name if you want. Okay. Quel, it's still what. Okay. In that case, it's written like that. So, we will see that in a coming lesson, but just to inform you, that's the masculine form, just because nom is masculine. And here, you've got the feminine form because nationalité is feminine. Okay. But then we pronounce them the same way. So, quel est, what is, votre, your, nom de famille, so family name or last name. Okay, it's a question. Quel est votre nom de famille? Okay, So it's not the opera or something that you want to sing, okay? So just raise a little bit your voice at the end of the question, okay? So the answer, c'est le François. So it's interesting because you can see that we've got this c'est here, and it doesn't show in the examples that we saw previously or for the conjugation, just because it's so. Well, basically you could translate it like it is or this is or yeah, it is, okay? C'est le François. Okay, and the last one, quelle est sa profession? Okay, quelle est sa profession? What is, so être, hein, same, sa, so it's her profession, okay? Elle est directrice. Elle est directrice. Okay, so she's a director, and then it's the feminine form here. All right? So the last lesson was introduction of le verbe être, okay, and I thought it would be more logical to continue with le verbe avoir. So avoir means to have, okay, and for the same reason as to be, okay, it's really useful and really used, so you should definitely know this verb avoir by heart if you want to master French language, okay? So let's see that, le verbe avoir, okay? And so we'll see the different forms. So the first one is j'ai. Okay? J'ai. All right? So if you remember correctly, we had this je, personal pronoun. And then when it comes near another vowel like a, for instance, then it tends to disappear. Okay? So just to avoid pronouncing this je, because we think that in French it doesn't sound that beautiful, so we tend to take this e away, okay, so that you get this sound je, okay, so j apostrophe a i. Remember, when you combine this a i, you get the e sound, okay? Second one, tu as, okay. As usual in French, final S is not pronounced. Tu as. Tu as. Okay, first one. J'ai. Tu as. Then comes il. So, masculine form. He. Okay. Il. He. Elle. She. Okay. And then a. So as you can notice, second form AS is pronounced A, and this is A. Same pronunciation in both cases, okay? Then, nous avons, final S not pronounced, avons, okay? And then we tend to make this little link, as I said previously in the lesson, for être, you make this link between the two, so nous avons, nous avons, okay, nous avons, nous avons, that's it. Next one, same thing, the little liaison, little link between the two, okay, vous avez, all right, and the last one, so same thing, if you can see, you get this final S and final S here, okay, and then you will have to make the little link between the two. Ils ont, ils ont, ils ont, okay, and then feminine form, elles ont, elles ont, all right, let's see the whole thing one more time. J'ai, tu as, il a, elle a, nous avons, vous avez, ils ont, elles ont. Okay? So let's see now. Just to make it more clear, remember, so I in French is je, you, it's tu, he, il, she, elle, we, nous, you, so as in English, first use for the plural, a group of person, okay, and then second use the polite form for you, one person. Okay, vous, il, elle. One last time. Je, tu, il, elle, nous, vous, il, elle. Discover le verbe aller. So the verb aller, aller means to go. So it's really useful because, well, we tend to use it like that. So for the main to go reason quite often. And we use it as also like in many languages for what we call the futur proche. So the near future. I am going to. And then you put a verb at the infinitive. So it is quite used, especially in the oral language. We tend to maybe use it a little bit more than the real future. Okay, so let's see how you conjugate this aller verb. The first form is je vais. Okay, so remember, final S not pronounced here. Je vais. Okay, when you combine this A-I, you get the sound A, really open, okay? Je vais, d'accord? Tu vas, final S doesn't exist. Tu vas, tu vas, okay? Then we've got this il, so remember, il, it's for the masculine form, so he, okay? And then elle, she, okay? And then you get the va form. Basically, you pronounce it like for the tu, because you don't pronounce the final S, okay? Il va, elle va, okay? Je vais, tu vas, il va, elle va. Then, nous, so we, plural form, nous allons, okay? And if you, so final S not pronounced, and then if you are purist, and I'm sure you are, you want to make this beautiful and little liaison, so this little link between the words, so it does mean that you will have to pronounce this z sound, okay? Listen to me. Nous allons. Nous allons. Okay? Nous allons. That's it. Same thing here. We'll have this little link between the two. Vous allez. Vous allez. And the last one. So remember, here you've got this S just to make the difference between the singular and the plural, because when you put the plural form, normally you tend to add S at the end of the words, okay, like here. But then you don't pronounce it. So, ils vont, final T, not pronounced. Ils vont. And then feminine form. Elles vont. All right, let's see everything again. Je vais, tu vas, il va, elle va, nous allons, vous allez, ils vont, elles vont. All right, and then just few examples. Just to show you how useful this aller verb can be, because we tend to use this aller verb when you want to ask if someone is doing fine, okay? So the first question, how do you do in French is comment, so how, comment, allez-vous? And then, same thing here, little link between the two. Comment allez-vous? Comment allez-vous? Alright, so I've been putting this vous form here for the first example, just to show you that if you meet someone for the first time, then it's, well, it's better to use this vous. So here, the vous form, so because it's the polite form. Okay, comment allez-vous? Okay, it's a question, so raise a little bit your voice at the end, like, comment allez-vous? Okay, you see, comment allez-vous? All right, so answer when you want to say, I'm doing fine, okay, je vais bien, and then you say, merci, thank you, je vais bien, merci. So now, if you know the person, okay, you get two options. I mean, normally that's the most used one. The first one would be, comment vas-tu? Okay, so in that case, you just switch and you change this you, so polite form, and you change it with this tu form, comment vas-tu? Okay, well, answer can be the same, you know, je vais bien, merci. Okay, and the other one, comment ça va? Okay, it would be like impersonal form. Okay, so you're not really addressing directly to the person. How is it going? Could be translated. Could be translated like that in English. Okay, comment ça va? Okay, you raise a little bit at the end. Comment ça va? And then same thing. You can answer with ça va, merci. Okay, so let's read them. Comment allez-vous? Je vais bien, merci. Comment vas-tu? Je vais bien, merci. Comment ça va? Ça va, merci. We'll discover le verbe s'appeler. So, previously we've been seeing three verbs. So the first one was être, to be, yeah, and then after that it was avoir, to have, and then in the previous lesson, it was aller, to go, and I thought it would be useful to introduce this s'appeler verb, because normally that's the verb you tend to use at the right beginning when you want to introduce yourself, because if you say my name is, well, in French we will use this s'appeler verb. Okay, it is always tricky and a big challenge for a French teacher to introduce this s'appeler verb at the real beginning, because it belongs to this group of verbs that we call verbes pronominaux. So you'll see why, because if you compare it to the others, something is coming there. Okay, so if you remember, when we conjugate a verb, first we put the pronom personnel, so the personal pronoun here, so je is like I. Okay, and then, so basically the verb appeler means to call. Okay, so without this S, okay, appeler is to call. Okay, and then when you had this S here, and then if you transform it like in this form, I call, and this is a pronoun, it's like me, so it's like I call myself, I call me, so it's just the way we've got in French to introduce ourselves. Okay, so it's je m'appelle. Okay, je m'appelle. All right, second form, tu t'appelles. Okay, remember, final S not pronounced, tu t'appelle. Okay, then il s'appelle, il s'appelle, elle s'appelle, elle s'appelle. And then the funny thing for nous or vous, you'll see that, well, basically we repeat it, or repeat, it's just a pronoun, so we call ourselves, if you want, okay, but then we put the pronoun before the verb. Okay, nous appelons, and then little link would be perfect, so let's pronounce the whole thing again. Nous appelons, nous appelons. Okay, final S doesn't exist. Nous appelons. Okay, then vous appelez, vous appelez. Okay, so you can hear, we put the little link again here. Vous vous appelez. All right. And the last one. Il s'appelle. Elle s'appelle. Okay, so one thing that you should remember, and probably you did here. Okay, so here for nous and vous, so we've got only one L, like here in the infinitive form. So that's the reason why I've been pronouncing appelons. Okay, and then appeler. All right, but for je, so if you can spot it here, look, we've got double L here, double L, and then for the plural form, double L. So when you get this E vowel, and then you get a double consonant, and well, they are the same, then it does change the pronunciation of E. You tend to pronounce it like E, E, really open. That's the reason why you pronounce it appel, appel, okay? Appel, 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 and appel. All right? So, as I said, that's the tricky thing with French language. I mean, you write them like here, without S, here, with S, and here, with E, N-T, N-T. You pronounce them the same way. Je m'appelle, tu t'appelles, il, elle s'appelle, il, elle s'appelle. Okay? All right. And now, a few examples. Comment vous vous appelez? Okay, so comment vous vous appelez? So when you want to know the name of someone, you know. Comment vous vous appelez? Answer. Je m'appelle Vincent. Et vous? Okay, so I am Vincent. I call myself Vincent if you want. Vincent. Et vous? And you, okay, so you want to know the name of the person who is asking this question, okay. The other possibility that you would have, you know, so first you've been starting with comment and then vous vous appelez, okay, so that's the, well, a common way of asking the question, all right. Other possibility would be to start with vous vous appelez, okay, so technically you just take the verb and then you put this comment, how, at the end, okay, it would be possible as well, okay, remember to raise your voice, vous vous appelez comment, all right, and the last one is the more correct form, okay, so first you should start with comment, how, and then, as in many languages, you should, well, change a little bit the order of the structure of the sentence, okay, vous appelez vous, okay, that's the real correct way to ask the name of someone, you know, comment vous appelez-vous, all right, and then you raise your voice, comment vous appelez-vous, all right, so let's repeat them, comment vous vous appelez, vous vous appelez comment, comment vous appelez-vous, all right. We'll discover in this lesson pour se présenter. So if you want to present yourself, okay, so it will be a really short lesson but still quite useful because, well, technically you will have to present yourself at one point when you speak with French people or French speaking people. Okay, so let's discover how it goes. The first one, well, you tend to use this appeler verb, okay, je m'appelle Vincent Lefrançois. Okay? Je m'appelle Vincent Lefrançois. So you use this s'appeler verb. So I did introduce this verb in the previous lesson. So it was leçon H. Okay? So if you didn't see this lesson, I definitely invite you to watch it. Because I tend to explain the reason why, you know, I've got this, well, there is this je m'appelle form, okay? So, je m'appelle Vincent Lefrançois. So, that's the first possibility you will have. The other possibility is to use this être, so to be, verb, je suis, I am, je suis Vincent Lefrançois. Okay, so the first one, je m'appelle, so basically, s'appeler, or je m'appelle, you could translate it directly, but, well, it's not really interesting, but still, you know, I call myself, okay, so that's the verb we tend to use when we introduce ourselves. Je m'appelle Vincent Lefrançois, okay, and then the second one, I am, je suis Vincent Lefrançois, and the last option we will have is mon nom, my name, mon nom est, is Vincent Lefrançois. Okay, first option, je m'appelle Vincent Lefrançois. Second, je suis Vincent Lefrançois. Last one, mon nom est Vincent Lefrançois. Of course, the first one is the most used. Okay, even if the verb is a bit tricky at the beginning, definitely you should work on it and you should, well, master this s'appeler verb because that's the one we will use when we introduce ourselves. Okay? Discover les articles définis, so definite articles. In English it would be the, okay, but in French, of course, as usual, we've got the difference between the masculine form, the feminine form, and the plural form, okay? And we start with the masculine form, so we've got le, le, okay? And then, in some cases, this vowel e, if it's close to other vowels, so if there is a word after that starting with a vowel, in some case it will have to disappear, okay? So you will get this L apostrophe, so that's the reason why I've been writing it here, okay? But then the main form is le, okay? Then la, feminine form, la, same for the same reason, you know, you will have this option L apostrophe as well. And then the plural form is les. Okay? So whereas in English you get only, there is only this the form, in French we will have the difference between the masculine form, le, the feminine form, la, and then the plural form, les. So, of course, according to the word, you will have to choose the correct article. So we'll take a few examples here. The first one is chien. Chien is a dog. And in French, chien, like that, it's masculine, so le chien. So basically, you just put the article le and then chien, okay? In that case, second case, ordinateur, well, you can see that it starts with the vowel O, okay? And as I said, you know, E and O, they don't get along that well, so you've got to take this E away, and then you get this l'ordinateur, l'ordinateur, all right? And third example, so I took on purpose this hôtel, okay, because it starts with H, but remember that in French we don't pronounce H, okay, so basically the first sound of the word is the vowel O, okay, so for the same reason, E needs to disappear, l'hôtel, okay, so if we repeat them, le chien, l'ordinateur, and then l'hôtel, okay? Feminine form, la famille, okay? So no problem, so family, la famille, okay? Then we've got argent, money, argent, same for the same reason, so a, l'argent, okay, you get to take this all the way, l'argent, and same thing as previously when what we saw for the masculine part, even if you've got this H, then the first sound you hear is A, okay, so for the same reason you will have to take this A away, and then you get this l'habitation, l'habitation, okay, and then I've been taking, well, basically the example from here, chien, okay, and then I put S at the end, and it's the mark of the plural, okay? So you put les chiens, the dogs, okay? Les chiens. And then you take famille, family, okay? Just add this final S, and you get the plural form, les familles, okay? Remember, chien, singular form, chien, same pronunciation, but you put this S, okay? Final S, not pronounced. Famille, singular form. Famille, plural form. Same pronunciation, S, not pronounced, okay? We'll discover les articles indéfinis. So, indefinite articles. So, in English, there is only one and it's a or an. Okay, and in French, we've got always the difference between the masculine form, the feminine form, and the plural form. As we saw in the previous lesson, remember, for the definite articles. Okay, it was the same. Okay, and in this lesson, so article indéfini, well, it's the same. We'll start with the masculine form, and the masculine form goes like that. So when you put these two letters together, it can be quite tricky to pronounce at the beginning. Of course, after that you will master it without any problem and without any doubt, but you've got to pronounce it like un. So it's what we call the nasal, so it goes in your nose, okay? So if you listen to me, you don't hear any N, okay? So it's just a combination of the two. All right? Okay, so that's the masculine form. Then the feminine article is here, and it's easier because if you have this U-N-E, then you pronounce it une, une. Okay, masculine, feminine form, une, une. Okay, and then the plural form, des. All right, here a S, you pronounce it like a. Okay, un, une, des. All right, let's see a few examples now. Okay, here ami means friend. Okay, un ami, and then we tend to make this little link between the two. Un ami. Okay, soleil, sun. Un soleil. Livre, book. Un livre. Voiture, car, feminine. Une voiture. École, school, feminine form as well. Une école. Décision. Une décision. Don't ask me to translate this décision. Come on, please. Ami, so I've been taking this now. Look, ami here. So we've got the masculine form and it's the singular. Remember, if you want to put the plural form, then you just add this final S here. Okay, but then technically you pronounce it the same way. So singular form, ami. Plural form, you add this S, but it's ami as well. Okay, in that case, you get de, so here de, okay, here, and then there is this little liaison, remember, it's been introduced in a previous lesson. You put this little link between the word, des amis, okay, I've been taking voiture here, voiture, a car, okay, just add this S at the end, and then you get the plural form, des voitures. Okay, and then I've been taking back this livre, same thing, you just add S at the end, des livres. Okay, let's repeat them one more time. Un, une, des. Un ami, un soleil, un livre, une voiture, une école, une décision, des amis, des voitures, des livres. Discover together l'article interrogatif. So it's really useful, and we'll see that now. So l'article interrogatif, here you get the masculine form and it's quel. Quel means what. Okay, so that's what you'll use when you want to ask a question with What, ok? And you've got a good example here. So, quel est votre nom de famille? What is votre, your, so the polite form of your, nom de famille, family name, last name, ok? Quel est votre nom de famille? What is your last name? Second example, quel est votre prénom? Prénom is first name. What is votre, the polite form for your, quel est votre prénom? What is your first name? Okay, so you can see now, more in detail, that nom, prénom are masculine words. And that's the reason why, in that case, you get to choose the article here according to the gender of the word it is connected to. Quel, masculine form, because nom is masculine. Quel, masculine form, because prénom is masculine. Okay, let's see now the feminine. And the good news is that, as usual in French, we write the thing differently, but then we can pronounce them the same way. And then the feminine form is written like that, Q-U-E-L-L-E, but it's pronounced like the masculine form. Quel at the masculine, quel at the feminine. Okay, so it's basically same pronunciation. Okay, and then here we've got two examples. So for the same reason as previously, we had this nom and then prénom. They were masculine words, so you will have to put this quel form at the masculine. And then here, nationalité and address. So nationality, address, are feminine words. So it does mean that you will have to use this article interrogatif, quel, at the feminine form. Quel est, what is, votre, your, nationalité? What is your nationality? Quelle est votre nationalité? Okay. Quelle est votre adresse? What is your address? Okay. So, let's repeat them. Quel est votre nom de famille? Quel est votre prénom? Quelle est votre nationalité? Quelle est votre adresse? Okay. So, remember one thing for the phonetics, okay, the way to pronounce them. Quel, masculine form here, will be pronounced exactly as the feminine form here. Quel. So, only one sound, okay? And then the second thing that you've got to remember, of course, you can, well, basically accord these articles with the word they are connected to. So it does mean that if the word is at the plural form, then you will have to put the plural form. The rule in French, if you remember correctly from the previous lessons we've been doing, is to put this final S at the end of the words to put the plural. Okay, so quel here for the masculine singular will become quel here, masculine plural. Okay, quel here, feminine singular, will become quel with the S, feminine plural. And the good news is that you will pronounce them the same way. Alright, so quel, 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 and quel. Okay, remember that in some cases, of course, you will have to make this little liaison, you know, this little link between the words. So if the word or the verb or whatever is coming after is starting with the vowel, of course you will have to put this little link. But then if you pronounce it, or if you pronounce them just like that, quel, 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 quel. Okay? Going to discover together les jours et les mois. So the days and the month. Okay? Les jours et les mois. So let's see that together. And so we'll start with les jours de la semaine. Okay, semaine is week. Les jours, so you can see that it's the plural form. Huh? The days, hein? Les jours of de la semaine. Les jours de la semaine, the days of the week. Okay, so we'll start with the first one. And in France, the week starts with lundi, Monday. Lundi, lundi. Okay, remember, UN is pronounced like un. Lundi, lundi, lundi. Then mardi, mardi. So you can hear that you don't pronounce it that strongly, this R. Hein? Mardi, mardi, okay? You don't need to go too deep like mardi, no, no, no. You don't move your tongue, so it doesn't sound like mardi, no. It's really soft, mardi, 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 okay? The next one is mercredi, mercredi, Wednesday, mercredi, mercredi, okay? Next one, jeudi. Jeudi. Remember, when you combine this E-U, you get the sound E. Jeudi. Jeudi. So I insist a little bit, so make it softer. Jeudi. Jeudi. Then, E-N, nasal, and it's en, en. So remember, vendredi. 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 Okay? Then, samedi, samedi, don't insist on the hein? Samedi, samedi, alright. And the last one, dimanche, dimanche. You get the sh, 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 and then an, en, en, dimanche. Okay, let's see them one more time. Lundi, mardi, mercredi, jeudi, vendredi, samedi, dimanche. Normally, in France, we tend to use this le weekend. So if we're talking about the weekend, okay, but then pronounce it the French way, weekend. Le weekend, okay? But then in other French-speaking countries, they tend to use this la fin de semaine, la fin de semaine, okay? But then in most of the cases, if you talk with French people, it will be le weekend, le weekend. If you want to talk about les mois de l'année, okay, année, year, mois, month, okay, les mois de l'année. So we'll see now the first one, January, so it looks, well, it looks a bit the same, no, no, wow, no, but anyway, janvier, so that's the way to pronounce it, janvier, A-N, en, okay, and then yé, 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 janvier, then comes février, février, okay, remember when you have this accent aigu on the top of then you pronounce it E, okay? There is a lesson regarding this topic, so don't be afraid. And if you're not sure about that, well, try to practice it. Février, février, okay? Then mars, okay? So in a way, it's an exception because normally final S is not pronounced in French, okay? We've got some exceptions, and this one is one of them. So mars, pronounce the final S, mars, mars, okay? Then avril, avril, avril. Nothing really tricky about this month, I mean, for the pronunciation, avril, okay? Here, be careful because people tend to try to pronounce it, to pronounce it the English way. In French, remember, when you combine this A and then E vowels, you get the sound A, A. So really open A, okay? And then you pronounce it me, me. Okay, so don't pronounce E, don't try to pronounce it. No, it's me, me. So it's not my, it's me, okay? And then here, well, it's a bit tricky, but still, EN goes like un, un, Okay? And then you get ju, juin, juin, juin. Okay, let's see them one more time. Janvier, février, mars, avril, mai, juin. Okay? Second round. Hop! Juillet. Okay, you get this double L here. Y-y-y-y-y. Juillet. Juillet. Don't pronounce this final T, E-T here at the end. E. Juillet. Juillet. So it's July. And then here, two options, because, well, two options are acceptable in French. The first one, you don't pronounce the final T. Ou. 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 Second one, you pronounce it. Août. 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 Alright, so remember, first option, don't pronounce it. Ou. 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 Second option, you pronounce it. Août. 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 Okay? Then, well, it's quite simple normally for an English-speaking person, so then it's quite close to other languages as well. So, septembre, septembre, septembre. Remember this E-M en septembre. Br, br. You don't insist on the final E. Septembre, septembre. Then, same thing here. Don't insist on the final E. Octobre, octobre. Octobre, novembre, 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 ok, E-M, en, novembre, novembre, and the last one, décembre, 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 same thing, E-M, en, décembre, ok, so let's repeat them, juillet, remember this, yeah, yeah, yeah. Juillet, ou, first option, août, second option, septembre, octobre, novembre, décembre. Okay? The little gift. L'hiver, l'hiver, and it means winter. So I've been putting this M here just to tell you that it's masculine. L'hiver. Le printemps, spring, l'été, l'été, summer, so I forgot to put it, but here I should put M because it's masculine, l'été, l'automne, l'automne, and same thing here, it should be M, automne, masculine. L'automne. Okay, so let's repeat it. L'hiver, le printemps, l'été, l'automne. And then, the last thing for this lesson, if you want to introduce the dates, okay, so if you want to tell what day it is today, so aujourd'hui means today. Aujourd'hui, today. Nous sommes, so we use the verb to be, okay, we are, nous sommes, le 8 juin 2012. Okay, so forget for the 2012, don't be afraid, we'll see that a bit later for the numbers, okay. Aujourd'hui, today, nous sommes, we are, le, you put the article, definite article, okay, and then you put the date here, okay, you start with the number, the month, and then the year. Okay, or then, second option, aujourd'hui, so it doesn't change, it's here, today, c'est, it is, this is, and then you put the date, le 8 juin 2012. Okay? Le masculin et le féminin. So let's see how we will modify some words that are masculine into a feminine form here. Because, for instance, we're talking about, well, whether professions or occupations. Here, student, assistant, actor, dancer, baker, and then computer scientist. It looks quite nice in English. Informaticien is nice, but still in English. Computer scientist, it's really interesting. Okay, so the rule in French is to add a at the end of a word to put the feminine form. Okay, so for instance here we've got étudiant, and then we've got assistant here. Okay, you just take it back here, étudiant, and then you will add this a at the end without modifying the first part. Okay, so it will of course change a little bit the pronunciation, because you will pronounce it at the masculine form. Il est étudiant. Okay, A-N-T, étudiant. Okay, but then for the feminine form, elle est étudiante. Okay, T, T, T. Okay, you don't really insist on the E, but you insist quite much on the T. Elle est étudiante. Il est assistant. So don't pronounce the final T here. But for the feminine form, elle est assistante. Okay? Étudiant, étudiante. Assistant, assistante. Alright? Then, we've got now the tricky ones. Il est acteur. Okay, so it's one of the irregular ones. E-U-R here, acteur, and it will become RIS. So E-U-R is becoming RIS. Elle est actrice. So acteur is becoming actrice. Okay, and then we've got a second group with this E-U-R combination. Il est danseur. E-U-R is becoming euse. Danseuse, okay? Danseur, masculine. Danseuse, feminine form. Il est danseur. Elle est danseuse, okay? Then we've got this group, like boulanger, boulanger, ER. So if you add this final E at the end, then you will have to put this accent here, accent grave. Remember, when you've got this E plus this accent grave, you pronounce it like E, really open E sound. Okay, so boulanger, boulanger, and then feminine form, boulangère, boulangère. Same thing, don't insist too much on the final E, boulangère. Okay, il est boulanger, elle est boulangère. Alright? And the last group is IEN, informaticien, yin, yin, yin. So that's the way to pronounce this IEN, yin, yin. Okay? Informaticien. Alright? And then, if you look carefully, then here, okay, you will have to double the N. And then add this final E, okay? And you get the sound informaticienne, sienne. Remember, E and then double N, or then it could be double L or double consonant here. You open your E, so it's E. Informaticienne. Okay, so I tend to insist a little bit, okay? Don't worry, I will pronounce it a bit more normally after. Il est informaticien. Elle est informaticienne. Okay, so let's see them one more time. Il est étudiant. Elle est étudiante. Il est assistant. Elle est assistante. Il est acteur. Elle est actrice. Il est danseur. Elle est danseuse. Il est boulanger. Elle est boulangère. Il est informaticien. Elle est informaticienne. We'll work on the vowels, les voyelles, in this lesson, and then we'll see how they behave when we combine them with another letter. So the vowels that we will work on, we won't take this Y vowel on purpose, okay? So we'll focus only on A, E, I, O, U. Okay, so remember, one more time, A, E, I, O, U. Okay, remember, this U is usually, can be quite tricky for English-speaking persons, especially the difference between the U and the U, okay, but we'll see that a bit later. So if you combine this vowel A with the vowel I, okay, you will get the sound A. So really open A. Okay, and then if you combine it with the vowel U, then you will get the sound O. O. All right. So well, exactly the same sound as this O vowel here. So it's the same O. Okay, and then if you combine it with the letter N, in that case you will get what we call a nasal. So it goes in your nose, and then you get the sound N. Okay, if you listen carefully, well, basically you don't listen, or you don't hear, sorry, any N in my pronunciation. Okay, let's see what happens with E. So E combined with the vowel E will give you the sound E. So the same sound as we had previously here. Okay, so it's the same sound, and it's E, so really open. And now if you combine it with the U, you will get the sound U. And if you combine it with N, then you get the sound A. So the same sound as we had when we combine N with A. Okay? A. Alright, so let's see now for E. So for E, obviously, if you get two times the same letter, then it will be a bit longer, so E. Okay, same thing for U, it doesn't really happen. And then here, that's the interesting one. If you combine E with N, then you will get the sound N. Okay, in your nose, N. Alright, so let's see O now. If you combine O and E, you will get the sound wa, 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 wa. So make it, repeat it like that, you know, wa, 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 wa. And then after that, only one, wa, okay? Then if you combine it with u, you will get the sound oo. So as I said previously, the difficulty, one of the big difficulty for English-speaking persons is this difference between the oo here and the u. Here, ooh, ooh. Okay, so we'll have the time to work on that, but still it's ooh in that case. If you combine it with N, then you will get the sound on. Same thing, nasal, so in your nose, on, on. All right, let's see the last one. So if you combine U and E, you get the sound ui, ui, ui. All right, so really U, it's not U, okay, so it's U, ui, ui, all right, and then, well, basically it doesn't exist, it's UO, and if you combine it with the N, then you get the sound UN. So before we had the difference between this UN here and this UN here, but nowadays in France, at least, you don't make any difference between the two, okay, so it's UN here and UN here. All right, so let's see them one more time. A, E, O, N. E, 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 N. I, N. ou ont eu huit un. Les 16 voyelles du français. So, I've been doing previously some videos covering the vowels in French, but then I thought it might be interesting to, well, see them a bit more precisely, because basically if we think about phonetics and French phonetics, we tend to think that we've got 16 vowels in French, okay? So we'll cover them, and for each sound I will give you three words, okay, so we can actually work on that quite precisely. Okay, and the first vowel is E, so like in merci, okay, merci. Then ri, okay, same vowel, I, ri, and then il, okay, so this one is actually quite simple to make, it's I. Okay, let's see the second, and it's E, okay, and in that case you get to E, été, parler, it's E, and then you get demander, okay, demander. So one more time, été, parler, demander. The next one, belle, so you can see that here it's quite open. Belle, belle. Same sound here. E, forêt, forêt. And here as well, E, M. Okay, so you get belle, forêt, M. Alright, so let's see. Numéro 4. And it's A, papa, okay, papa, ma, ma, lac, lac, okay, so one more time, papa, ma, lac, numéro 5, ba. So this one is a bit lower, actually, so it goes deeper, it's ba. Same thing here, when you get this circumflex, lâche. Okay, so this a is actually lower or deeper than the previous we had, okay? Ba, lâche. Porte. So you get this O, and it's actually quite open in that case. It's O, porte, okay? But, same thing, you get this O, but it's quite open, so but. Paul, same thing, okay? So, porte, but, Paul. And of course, the deeper one, bo, okay, so this one is really, really low or deep, bo, do, same thing here, I tend to make them longer, of course, huh? Do, and then sauter, okay, so bo, do, sauter. So you can hear the difference between what we had previously and now, okay? These ones are actually, they go deeper. And now we've got this oo sound, foo. This one is usually not that tricky to make. Doo, loo. Okay, so one more time. Foo, doo, loo. Okay, fou, dou, lou. Let's see, numéro 9. And it's U, okay? Tu. This one can be tricky for some students who have, well, who are English-speaking persons, or then, in some cases, some students from Spanish-speaking countries. So try to insist on that. Okay, it's really, really, really narrow. Okay, same thing here. Well, it's the verb. Normally, it shouldn't be pronounced like that, but keep in mind that when you use it, it's the verb to have. Plus. Okay. Tu. U. Plus. In that case, just to avoid any misunderstanding, remember it's the participe passé of avoir, okay, that you use when you use these compound tenses, like passé composé, for instance. Il a eu. Okay, you write it like that, but you pronounce it eu. Okay. So, tu, here the participe passé, eu, and then plus. Peu, bleu, feu. Okay, so this sound is e, e. Okay, peu, bleu, feu, e. And then we will have a little bit the same, but it's a bit lighter, more open, and it's peur. Okay, previously it was bleu, so really, really deep, bleu. This one is more open and it's peur. Okay, peur. Here it's the same, œuvre. Œuvre. Jeune. Same thing, you don't say je, you say jeune, okay? So it goes like peur, œuvre, jeune, okay? Numéro 12. Le. So basically it's this sound, and you get the same in here, in me, and also regarder. Regarder. Okay, so you get le, me, regarder. Numéro 13, it's this un. So nasal, it goes in your nose. Un, fin. Okay, fin. Un, fin. Then another example. Brun, brun. Okay, fin. Brun, fin. So you write it differently, but then you pronounce it like the first one. It's un, un, okay? Fin, brun, fin. All right? So in some cases, students tend to struggle with les nasales, but trust me, if you try hard, normally you can master them. So it's just a question of time. You just need to practice, practice, and practice. So let's see, numéro 14. Numéro 14, and it goes like un. So if you compare it to the previous one, well, in many situations nowadays, if I'm really honest, difference between the two is quite narrow and almost invisible. But then, well, phonetics like to make some differences between the two, so this one should be a bit deeper in a way, and it's un. Okay, the previous one was un, this one is un. Alright? Brun, same thing. It's not brun, but it's brun. Alright? Un, un, and the last one would be humble. Okay, so you've got un, brun, humble. One more time. Un, brun, humble. Numéro 15. Numéro 15, you've got the sound en. Dans. Okay? Dans. Second example. Blanchir. Blanc, blanc, blanchir. And then sentir. Same thing here. En, okay, dans, blanchir, sentir. In many situations, when you practice on your own and when you try to reach this sound, try to make the sound longer, okay, and try to insist. So you can do it like dans, just to practice that. And after that, you can make them shorter and like more normal, okay? So dans, blanchir, insist. Sentir, okay, sentir, and after that you can make normally like dans, blanchir, sentir. Let's see now the last one, and it's same thing, nasal, it goes in your nose, and then your mouth should be like really round, blond, blond, okay, then fond. And last, tomber, okay, tomber, blond, fond, tomber. One more time, blond, fond, tomber. They are normally quite tough to make, okay, but then it's just, as I said, a question of time. So try your best and don't worry, you will manage to pronounce them. L'euphonie. Okay, so we can start right now. So the question is, of course, what is l'euphonie? And it's a good question because it will be quite important when we talk about using the French language. So basically, l'euphonie is the idea that we will produce des sons agréables à entendre. So sounds that will be nice to hear. Okay, or then des sons plus facile à prononcer, sounds easier to pronounce. And this is an important thing when we talk about French language. It does mean that we will, in some cases, don't respect the grammatical rules just to modify the language to make it whether easier to pronounce or then nicer. Okay, so we'll see in this video the contractions, the liaisons, the inversion, then the special adjectives, the imperative form, and then this long form. Okay, because in all these cases, actually, l'euphonie will have actually something to say and something to modify. Okay, so we can start now with les contractions. And we've been seeing that quite many times before. When we've got this je ai form, for instance, we get what we call a hiatus. Okay, so it's a quite difficult word, but that it does mean that you've got two vowels here, or two sounds of the vowels that will belong to different syllables, okay, and so they don't get along, and that's the main reason why we will have to modify it. We will have to take away this here, and we will get this j. In the same situation, when you get le arbre, you get this hiatus, and then you will have to take away your here just to get this l'arbre form. Same thing here, la ami. You take away your R and then you will get l'ami. And finally, here, je utilise, same situation, sorry. You will have to take away your E just to get this j'utilise form. Okay, so j'ai, l'arbre, l'ami, j'utilise. Okay, so just for this reason, you will have to, so the hiatus reason, you'll have to take this E. And then away. All right. So second situation now, and we're talking about les liaisons. Okay, so les liaisons, it's quite important because we tend to make them quite often. I've been making some videos. If you want to watch them, I explain a lot of things regarding the liaison, okay? But then in this case, we will actually only focus on this euphony aspect. So we get this nous avons, okay? So nous avons, and then basically in that case for, well, aesthetical and then practical reasons, we will make this little link between the two and we will get nous avons, okay? So nous avons will become nous avons. Then vous avez eu will become vous avez eu. Okay, so you can see that here you get the first liaison and then the second one here. And in the same way, ils ont eu will become ils ont eu. Nous avons, vous avez eu, ils ont eu. So let's see now what we call l'inversion. And then you can see here the letter T. Okay, so l'inversion. So normally remember when you construct a sentence, you've got first the verb, first the subject, then the verb. Okay, so il a. And then if you want to ask a question, normally we should change the order and put first now, first the verb, then the subject. Okay, but then a il looks a bit strange, it sounds a bit strange, and that's the reason why we will have to modify it and we will add this T here. Okay, so you will get this form a-t-il. All right, so il a should become a-il, but then it doesn't sound nice, so it's a-t-il. All right, in the same way, elle parle, so subject verb, we should put that like that, verb subject parle elle. For the same reason, we will put this T between the two. Parle-t-elle? Il aime. Aime-il? Will become aime-t-il. Alright, so it's actually quite simple. If you look carefully, you've got here a vowel, vowel, vowel. Then in these cases, you will have to add this T between the two. Alright? So, a-t-il, parle-t-elle, aime-t-il? And of course, it doesn't change if after parle, well, you've got je, or you've got tu, or you get other persons, because basically they don't start with a vowel, so the problem won't occur. Okay? So, let's see now what we call spécial, les adjectifs spéciaux, pardon, special adjectives. And we're talking about only three adjectives. And the first one is beau, beautiful, nice. Un beau homme. So it's actually quite interesting because in this case, beau homme, well, you can see that phonetically it's quite challenging to produce. So that's the reason why we will actually, instead of using this beau, use the second version that we have. So it will be belle. So it does mean that this adjective has two masculine form. So you've got beau and then you will have belle. Okay, so this belle we'll use for all the words that will come after, starting with the sound of a vowel. And you will get un bel homme. Un bel homme. Okay? So remember, I say the sound of a vowel because, of course, if you look carefully, you've got H here, okay? And it's not a vowel at all. But then in French, we don't pronounce it. So the first thing that you hear, it's so it's O, it's the vowel here. And that's the main reason why we will have to use this belle form, okay? So remember, beau masculin and then belle as well, written like that, masculin. The second adjective that will be modified is nouveau, okay? Un nouveau ordinateur. So You will have to modify nouveau and you will get the second masculine form of nouveau, and it's nouvelle, so that you will use for all the words that start with the sound of a vowel. Un nouvel ordinateur. And the last one is vieux, old, un vieux arbre. Okay, of course you've got this X at the end, but you don't pronounce it. Okay, so it's vieux arbre, and then vieux actually will have a second masculine form, and it's vieille. Okay, you get un vieil arbre. All right, so un bel homme, un nouvel ordinateur, un vieil arbre. Let's see now the imperative form, so l'impératif. And it's actually quite interesting because l'impératif, if you combine it with le pronom Y, so pronounced it, and then le pronom en, we'll see how it works. Because, for instance, you take the verb aller. Aller is really tricky, so take the time and concentrate now. So let's see, aller. Aller normally at the imperative should be va, just like that. So we're talking here about the tu person, okay? And then if you want to combine it with the pronoun I or Y here, then it will become vas-y. And when I spoke about the fact that this euphony can actually modify the grammar, you've got a good situation here, because basically, even if the form is normally va like that, you will have to modify it and put this S here just to get the sound vas-y instead of va-y. Okay? Vas-y. Alright, so va is tricky because we've got the second example, and so as we saw previously, it's va, okay? And then if you combine it with the pronoun en, then it will become va-t'en. So you will keep the normal form, but then you will add this t between the verb and the pronoun va-t'en. Okay, in other situations like penser, for instance, if you look carefully, pense, okay, and then you want to put the I, alright, so in that case, you will change the grammar as well, and you will keep the S that we normally have at the present form, okay, pense-y, pense-y, alright, so you don't keep the normal imperative form for tu, but then you will put this S. Pense-y. Another example, chanter, okay, chante, and then you put en after. Chantes-en, okay, could be chantes-en une, chantes-en. Alright, so keep in mind that you will have to keep this S, z, chantes-en, okay, to have this link between the two. And the last, but not the least, and it's long, okay? So let's see, oops, my L is already there. Si plus on, so as we saw, it will create what we call a hiatus, okay? And that's the main reason why it was here from the start. You will have to add this L just to get si long. All right, so if you say si well, basically, we think that it doesn't sound that nice. You can hear it. Honestly, you can hear it. But still, if you want to, use the language in a correct way, you should definitely add this L between the two just to get this form si long. Okay? Si on veut will become si l'on veut. Si on peut will become si l'on peut. Si on doit will become si l'on doit. Okay? Si l'on veut, si l'on peut, si l'on doit. les prépositions. So we've been covering, of course, les prépositions quite many times in different videos, but then this video will only focus on les prépositions, okay? So we can start right now. A, and then you get the translation each time. À cause de, à côté de, à défaut de, à force de, à la faveur de, à la merci de, à l'égard de, à l'encontre de, à l'entour de, à l'exception de, à l'instar de, à l'insu de, à même, à moins de, à partir de, à raison de, à seule fin de, à travers, afin de, après, au lieu de, au moyen de, au prix de, au vu de, au dedans de, au-dessous de, au-dessus de, auprès de, autour de, aux alentours de, aux environs de, avant, avec, chez, concernant, conformément à, contre, dans, d'après, de, aux dépens de façon à, de la part de manière à, We'll discover les chiffres in this lesson. I hope you're ready because it's starting right now. Les chiffres. Zero. Zero. Okay, so remember, you get this z and then e accent aigu, zero. Okay, then un. All right, so when you combine this u and n, you get the nasal sound un, un. Deux. Final x not pronounced, okay. Deux. Trois. Final s not pronounced. Trois. Quatre. Quatre. Okay, so remember that even if you get this u vowel here, basically you don't pronounce it, because that's the rule in French. When we get this q letter and then a vowel after, then we will have to put this u. Okay, so you get this q u a, but then the sound that you will pronounce is k. Okay, quatre, quatre. All right, and next, cinq, cinq, cinq. Then be careful here, because even if it's ending with this X, well, you'll have to pronounce it like S, S, okay? So you get the six pronunciation, six, six, okay? So it's not six, it's six, all right? Then here, remember, P is not pronounced, okay? It doesn't exist, so you get this set sound, set, set. Okay, then here final T is pronounced, so huit, huit. Remember in French this H letter here, okay, doesn't exist phonetically, so we don't really pronounce it, okay, so if you listen carefully, you will only listen or hear these vowels at the beginning of the word, huit, huit, okay, and then neuf. 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 Okay?